Good afternoon, good morning, good evening. Welcome back to Ariopa webinars, the 35th one this time. Today we have our guest, Stefan Strube, who will give, let's say, his view on Microsoft Dataverse, or what was known as the Common Data System. As the title says, what's in it for us? Welcome, everybody. As always, I will go through a couple of, housekeeping things. Your microphone is muted. If you have questions, feel free to post them in the GoToWebinar window. I will pick them up. I'm Luc van Vugt, and I'm your moderator today. I have agreed with Stefan that I will post the questions as soon as he has a slot to post them. If it really makes sense to step in, I will do that too. But nevertheless, come up with your questions and we'll pick them up while going on. The recording will be put on YouTube again. The recording is already running, be aware of that. And we'll share that somewhere within the hour after we close down today. If you haven't been subscribed to our newsletter yet, feel free to do that and let the message go around that anybody subscribes to it to get in the know of when we're going to have any next webinars. For the coming weeks, we will deviate from our bi-weekly rhythm because we'll have a series of four webinars around AL VS Code extensions that were built by community members. And we'll start next week, Tuesday, with Waldemar, André and David, that they are going to do a short demo on their extension for VS Code. And on June 1st, that's the week after, so that's closely after each other, we'll have a next one. Then we'll skip, Then we will skip 2 weeks again because of the Tuesday, the 8th, that I have something set already. And then on June 22, we'll close with the last group. Of course, every next webinar will show this program again. Feel welcome to join in then and maybe put a special stress on this because it would be nice if a lot of people are going to join in on those sessions because all of these have been putting a lot of their free time and giving those extensions freely available to all of us. And it might be a kind of, compliment to them if you would join our sessions. As you know, we're always looking for any speakers on topics that make sense to share information with the community. Before I'm going to hand off to Stefan, and Stefan is a fellow MVP who is his main focus is on Power Apps from the MVP site. He's going to talk about Dataverse today. Before I'm going to hand off to you, Stefan, thanks to our sponsor, Fornaf, who makes this available or possible that we can share this using GoToWebinar. Stefan, I'm going to make you as presenter, and let's check whether everything is working right. So feel free to share your screen. Yeah, I can see it. So I reckon anybody else can see it too. Your microphone is unmuted, I guess. So we should be able to hear you.
Yes. Thank you for your question, Luc.
You're welcome.
I take it over from here?
Yes, and enjoy it.
Okay. Yeah, thank you very much. So welcome, everybody, and thank you for joining this session. Session about Microsoft Dataverse, what's in it for us being the Dynamics 365 ERP people. So let's first introduce my...
My mic was muted, but yours was also muted, Stefan, where you started to introduce yourself. I don't know.
Oh, yeah. I saw it. I think I clicked... clicked in the wrong screen.
So let's act that this didn't happen. Go ahead.
Yeah, the slides speak for itself. So I can. No, okay. But okay. I work as a solution architect at Structon in the Netherlands. Structon is an end user of the Dynamics 365 sales application of Power Platform. And I'm a Microsoft Business Application MVP. Also want to mention that I'm a co-founder of originally two user groups here in the Netherlands, one for Dynamics 365 customer engagement and one for Power Apps and Flow. But we merged them into one. It's called the Power Addicts NL user group. And we have been doing virtual events until we can do and go over to in person again. So you can follow me on Twitter or LinkedIn. And I also have a blog site where I post some articles about my findings. So I have a kind of a feeling of a deja vu for this session, because this is me 3 years ago at the Dutch Dynamics Community Year event. And in fact, I was talking here about Dataverse. It wasn't called that way, but yeah, my session was about model-driven apps powered by Dynamics 365. And yeah, in a way, I was promoting Dataverse. So it's 3 years ago, and I looked at slides, and a lot of things are still kind of accurate and valid, and a lot of things aren't. So it's good to have a notion of past, present, and the future, and to refer to two famous quotes. And you have to know the past to understand the present. And we started the past to understand the present. We understand the present to guide the future. That's also the way I set up my session today. So I will deal with the past. I will give a brief history of what has become known as Dataverse. The present, so what is Microsoft Dataverse? Where can I find it in the Microsoft clouds? Some interesting features to mention. And then what's in it for us, the ERP people. And then, some look into the future. If you're interested, how you're able to start with Dataverse. Of course, a nice topic about licensing and what's next on the release wave. So to start with the past, here's a brief history of the platform that became known as Dataverse. So it all started with Dynamics CRM. That has been part of the Dynamics business applications suite a long time. And yeah, it has developed itself as a platform, online platform, since 2003. Well, all these business applications, they had their own ecosystem. So there were in one group, but yeah, they were really not that integrated. So in 2017, Microsoft came up with the idea to rebrand the business applications and make them one family under the name of Dynamics 365. Now, that was the reason for a lot of confusion, one name to confuse them all. That name implicated that, it was an integrated platform of business application, but that was not the case. So in April 2018, it was also the reason for my session at the Dynamics Community event. The first important step was made to create integration for these business applications. So Dynamics 365 Customer Engagement, that's the new name of CRM, was integrated with Power Apps. And that was the birth of a pure XRM platform called Common Data Service for Apps. In fact, it was the version 2 of CDS, the version 2 of the Common Data Service. New start based on a new concept. The platform was adopted from the Dynamics CRM platform. Now, along the way, the four apps disappeared in the name, so it was known as Common Data Service. And then last year in July, Microsoft announced a new name called Microsoft Dataflex. Well, there was a software company that had a registered trademark with that name, so they started a lawsuit and Microsoft had to withdraw it. So in a matter of weeks, the name disappeared from all the documentation. There were two versions of Dataflex, one for the Power Platform business application and one for Teams. Common Data Service was the name that they maintained. And the solution, the platform for Teams was called Project Odell. Now, last November in 2020, again, a rebranding of the name, and this time, Dataverse here to stay, Microsoft Dataverse, and the version for Teams called Microsoft Dataverse for Teams. So what is Microsoft Dataverse and where to find it? Interesting features and what's in it for us. So let's start with what is Microsoft Dataverse. So if you take a look at the Microsoft clouds, you have these building blocks, these four different clouds. Microsoft 365, the collaboration and productivity suite, then the group of Microsoft Dynamics 365 business applications, Microsoft Power Platform as a no-code, low-code platform, and then Microsoft Azure. So in 2018, Dynamics CRM or customer engagement was integrated with Power Apps. So you see that was an important step in the road on into further integration of these two clouds. If you zoom into the Microsoft Power Platform, you'll see that Dataverse is part of it. And Dataverse is like a data platform. So data is stored in Dataverse. You can use all kinds of connectors to get data in, get data out, and you can run your apps and flows on it and report on Dataverse in your Power BI dashboards. So Microsoft Dataverse is a data platform. It's like Microsoft wants it to become the universe of your data. Does it mean that all your data should be in Dataverse? Not necessarily. So Dataverse can store data. There are different techniques, technologies that you can use to get the data in, like data flows, Power Query, Excel add-ins, and connectors. And there is also a way to replicate or synchronize the data to other storage facilities, like Azure Data Lake, Azure SQL. It's a new feature that's coming with the release wave this year. And a data Excel server, this existing service to replicate data to Azure SQL database. But it's more than a platform. So this is an image from Microsoft. There's a lot of text on it, and the contrast with the green and the black background is not that bad, not that good. So, but you see that it offers a lot of things. So it supports different clients. There are a lot of things that has to do with data. So you can create your own custom tables. It's based on a common data model. I will talk about it later. A lot of integration possibilities, security and compliance is important. All kinds of business logic reporting, and also environment lifecycle, application lifecycle management is also a very important part of Dataverse. So what's behind Dataverse? Like I said, it's a data platform, and it's not just storage. The storage itself is divided in different kinds of storage, as the text here also reveals. The relational data is stored in Azure SQL. The file data is files are stored in Azure Storage. The audit logs are stored in Cosmic DB, and also data is exposed to cognitive search for a better search experience. So you see that it's a platform with a lot of possibilities and running on Azure, which gives it a lot of scalability. Here's another picture. It's a bit more clear. So Dataverse offers different kind of technology and functionality. So first, it's got an API, so you can interface with it. There are a lot of options for security. It offers also logic, so it's also a platform to build your apps as well. That was also my session in 2018, because with Dataverse, you're able to build model-driven apps. All the like in CRM, we do in Dynamics 365 Customer Engagement. we're able to build our apps and using custom tables, logic, all kinds of things. So it's a pure XRM platform, and you are able to create your own apps. So where to find Microsoft Dataverse? I will switch over to a browser. So if you're in a Microsoft cloud, you need a Microsoft 365 tenant. And if you're talking about the Power Platform, and Dataverse is part of the Power Platform, you can either go to Power Apps, Power Automate, or Power Apps. Dataverse is using so-called environments. And within the maker portals of Power Apps and Power Automate, you will see here that you have an environment picker. Now, all Microsoft 365 tenants have a default environment, like shown in this demo tenant. So, for instance, how do you know if Dataverse is available, yes or no? So, for instance, like I said, if Dataverse is available, you're able to create model-driven apps. So if I'm going to try to create a model-driven app, it will tell me that no database was found. So in this environment, Dataverse is not available. The same is for here. Once Dataverse is available, database, I should be able to see the tables that are present in this environment. Again, no database is found. So this is the evidence that Dataverse is not enabled, not active. There's no database in this environment. Now, I have a demo tenant also with Dynamics 365 Custom Engagement. And if I now go to tables in the navigation, you will see that this is the proof that Dataverse is there, is enabled. Back to the slide. So if you want to enable Microsoft Dataverse, you have to go to the Power Platform Admin Center. Now, to get access to that Power Platform Admin Center, you have to have one of these three roles. So either Global Administrator, Power Platform Administrator, or Dynamics 365 Administrator. And this is the URL of the Power Platform Admin Center. It is a short URL, or you can find it from the admin center in Microsoft 365 as well. So back to the browser. So you see here, I can switch to Power Platform Admin Center or from Power Apps. You see there's also an option here. Now, this is your admin center to deal with the environments. It offers you some analytics, some functionality for governance, security, things like that. So let me say default, yes. So this will be the normal view when you have a Microsoft 365 tenant with only one environment. I'm going to speak more about environments. So what is an environment? It's in a container in which end users with make permission can create and share resources and data. And if you create an environment, you can choose a geographic location. So you're able to create an environment in EMEA or United States or whatever data center there's available. So you can create an environment close to your users. There are seven types of environments. I will come to that later. And like I showed you, every tenant has a default environment. Now, the best practice is that you should not use the default environment for business apps, for production apps, and you should create additional environments so you have more permission controls. You can also restrict some access to those environments. If you're talking about business applications, you want to have strict control about who can access and the permissions and security, things like that. So there are seven types of environments. So to start with, the default, that's auto-created. all the users, that's important to understand, all the users are by default have the role of environment makers. That means they can create their own apps, they can create their power automate flows, and you can't restrict that. Microsoft makes it really easy to let users go and try, which is in a way good. So people who are handy with the technology can create beautiful things and then maybe get in touch with IT to take to the next level if there's a good reason for that. So if you're talking about business applications, you might want to create a production environment, additional one. So that's a type of environments. You can also create sandboxes, so you can use these sandboxes for development and testing, trial environments, so they have a limited time that are usable. But create a trial environment to show you how it's done. A developer, that's also interesting. Every licensed user enable a community. Can create his own personal environment, and you can start exploring Dataverse and all the possibilities. So it's something to recommend, and I will come back to that later. And then there's also the sixth type of Dataverse for Teams. So you're able to add apps to a team, to Microsoft Teams, and this will then Dataverse for Teams will be auto-created for that team. And in case you have a ticket with Microsoft, they can create a copy of your environment, and so that will be type support. So again, default environments is there. And one of the recommendations is you should rename it like personal productivity to make sure that people understand, well, this is not for business applications. So go back to my Power Platform Admin Center. Now, if you want to create an environment, you can create a new environment, and I will choose this option. So here you see that you have an option, production, sandbox, and trial. You can specify the region, and I'm going to create a database for this environment. To be able to use Dataverse, you need to create a database. Now, on this next step, you can select the default language for this environment, for Dataverse. You can choose an URL and then the currency. And now this option is important because at the moment it's not possible to enable Dynamics 365 apps after you created your Dataverse environment. So if you're willing to use Dynamics 365 apps now or maybe in the future, you should choose this option. But I'm not going to do it. So I will show you what will be the result of this. So now it's going to create an environment with Dataverse. Will this Dataverse database will be empty or not? No, this will not be an empty database. Then I have to talk a bit about the so-called common data model. So Microsoft started this open source initiative to define a common data model. And it's a standard extensible collection of schemas. And it's about tables, attributes, relationships that represents business concepts. So most of the applications, they use a table to store company info, a table for contact person info, table for this activities, user table, business unit table, company table. So they made up a common data model, and there is just a base, the base tables of the core tables that are will be part of the Dataverse environment I just created. So this is, you'll find this on GitHub. So they published this as open source in GitHub. And there's an entity browser of Navigator, so you can look at all the entities. So here's a poster of it. You see on the left, if you enable Dataverse without Dynamics, you will get these core tables. So no data, no empty database, you can start creating your apps with these standard tables. Of course, you can add your custom data tables as well. Once you have enabled Dataverse also for Dynamics 365 apps, and you enable the sales app or the service customer service app, extra tables will be added to Dataverse. So the list of tables will be expanding. So one thing about good thing about the common data model is that it's also available in Power BI data flows and Azure Data Lake Gen 2. So it's possible to replicate data through these technology data flows and to Azure Data Lake, but you can give it the metadata based on the common data model. So therefore it remains structured data and it can be beneficial for your reporting. So that's also another advantage of using the common data model. So I will refresh it. Now you see that I've created a demo environment. And if I open this environment, you will see that there's a database version. And it means that Dataverse is available. So if I go back to Power Apps, you see that now I'm able to choose this environment as well. And you will see that there will be tables available in this newly created environment with Dataverse. Okay, you see here the same table names that were also mentioned in the common data model, the core tables. So I can start creating a model-driven app and I can create my own CRM, for instance. I don't need Dynamics 365 sales. If I want to have a really simple CRM, I can use the core records, the core tables, and add my own custom tables to it. So I'm able to create the solution I want. Now, if you look at the environments, there are several possibilities of securing such an environment. For instance, you can add a security group to it. So only people who are a member of the security group are able to get access. And the combination of being a member of the security group and a valid license will give them access. So they will be added as an active user to the environment. And within the environment, you can add security roles to those users. So there are different levels of security. This also mentioned is this slide. I copied some slides from the Admin in a Day workshop. It's a really this is a community effort together with Microsoft. And the content of these presentations are really give you the full story about Dataverse, also the Power Platform. So I can recommend that you download the content from the GitHub site. So you're able to secure these data environment, Dataverse environments based on a security group. You can also restrict the access to apps. And then based on security roles, people can either read or you can say what kind of privilege they are going to have for the create, read, update, and delete operations. So there are some out-of-the-box security roles that are available. Environment admin, environment maker. In the default environments, every user is environment maker, so they can create their own apps and flows. And yeah, if you have Dataverse enabled, you also have these additional three. So back to the environments. Yeah. Now there are some interesting features to mention. I'll show you the picture of what's Dataverse of Microsoft with a lot of features. I've just mentioned some that are interesting to me and also for you. So like in 2018, virtual tables, it was called virtual entities, were also already there, but they were still in preview. But nowadays, they have a support for CRUD operations, and they are also generally available. So this is a real milestone, and there are two out-of-the-box data providers, one for OData and one for CosmicDB, but you're able to create your own data provider. And also for finance operation, also for Business Central, this functionality is available. So for F&O, it's already generally available, and for Business Central, it's still in preview, but it will be generally available one day. So Microsoft Dataverse connectors, because it's such an important central part of Power Platform, you'll find Dataverse connectors for every part of the for every application or belonging to the Power Platform. So Power Automate Flow has its Microsoft Dataverse connector. Power Apps Canvas Apps is also a native connector to Dataverse. There's an Excel add-in. There's also TDS endpoint. So from SQL Management Studio or from Power BI, you're able to create these kind of queries. The SQL syntax. Now with Power BI, there are four ways to get connected to Dataverse. So you can use the web API with the OData connector, the deprecated Dynamics 65 connector, the Common Data Service Legacy connector, but the most recent one is the Dataverse connector, and it's based on the Tabular Data Stream protocol. So, and you can also use that in the combination with Direct Query. Now, and Business Central has also his connector for the synchronization. So these are the triggers and actions of the Dataverse connector in Power Automate Flow. So yeah, you can let the flow trigger when a row or record is created, modified, or either deleted, or a combination of these triggers. And then there's a new one in preview. When some action is performed, like when an opportunity is closed, for instance, and then you have this list of actions. So it's really powerful, and there are a lot of so-called bound and unbound actions that are work-like functions and actions. So you can create or update rows, records, but you can also do more with functions. So it's really powerful. Now, another thing that's interesting is so-called solutions. We talk about application lifecycle management. And if you want to have enterprise-grade business applications, you want to be able to develop your apps and then push them through a test or acceptance. And finally, you want to push them to production. Now, I showed you in the Maker portal, you see down here the solution option in navigation. And you see, by enabling Dataverse in this environment, the system pushed these solutions to this environment. And in these solutions, these components are available, like the tables, the core tables, I think the other one. Yeah. So you see, I can filter here on table, for instance. You see that the default solution contains all these core tables. Now, I'm able to create my own solution. It's a bit like expressions in Business Central, although this concept already exists for a long time. It's adopted from Dynamics CRM. I'm able to create my solutions. I can add existing components and add my own custom fields to it or relationships. I can add my custom tables. So I can create the base, the data model for my apps, but not only the tables with attributes, forms, and views, but also other components. So with the integration of Dynamics 365 Customer Engagement and Power Apps in 2018, Microsoft has started to make all the components so-called solution aware. So that we are able to add them to a solution. And there's a long list that's already solution aware. So you see that you can add a lot of components that are part of your solution or your apps. So the idea is you develop your customizations, your apps in a dev environment, you package them into solutions, and you can publish them to another environment. Really powerful. Okay, now that data first for developers. So there are a lot of features that are interesting for developers. So there's a web API you can connect to. There's also some function actions, like I said before in the data first connectors. There's more or less parity with the web API. So a lot of powerful functions and actions. You're able to register webhooks that can call an external API. So for instance, an Azure function or Power Automate Flow. You can develop your own plugins. There are some integrations with Azure Service Bus and Event Hub. And when you use Azure DevOps or GitHub, you can also do source control and build your own release pipelines fully automated. And that is just a short list. There are a lot of features also interesting for developers. Okay, so what's in it for us? And us being Dynamics 365 ERP people. So what has data first to offer? What can be of added value for either Business Central or Finance Operations? So for Business Central, I came up with these two concepts. You're able to use fire up Power Apps portals and maybe set up a central CRM master data in Dataverse. The first one, as far as I know, Business Central lacks the functionality of a portal, so a way to expose data from Business Central to external users like partners or customers. I believe in the past there was an employee portal, but it was something from the past. So I think this can be really interesting once virtual tables are becoming generally available and also will support the CRUD operations. That will make it possible to expose your data in Dataverse, and you can build a Power Apps portal on Dataverse. So you can create your own partner portal and interact with your clients, with your customers or partners. Now, I can imagine that once this become generally available in the Maker portal, you will going to find templates for these scenarios. Portal. I'll find it, but there you can normally you can create templates from based on a template. So that can be interesting once virtual tables that are still in preview will be GA and with CRUD support. Another concept is this. This is also something that's reality in our company where I work. So we have one central CRM system, but we have different business central databases. So we have another company, different companies in the Netherlands, but they have their own business central database. We have some companies abroad. They also have their business central database. So it can be interesting to have a central CRM, and based on the synchronization that's André Baloudin demoed in some sessions, some webinars, webinar in some weeks ago. You were able to exchange data between Dataverse and Business Central. So I mentioned here CRM, but can be based on the vanilla Dataverse. So no Dynamics apps. You can use it with or without Dynamics apps enabled. You can build your own custom tables and use the core tables to build your CRM app. And you can exchange information between the central CRM system and the Business Central databases. It's either for CRM or maybe master data, and it's just out of the box functionality. So it can be interesting. For finance operation, I guess I'm not really familiar with that, so I'm not really a specialist in finance operations. So I'm not sure if they have a portal offering, but yeah, finance operations has two integrations with Dataverse via dual write and virtual entities. So yeah, exposing data from F&O in your portal is possible. And you can see that in the Maker portal, there is already a template available to create a customer portal in combination with Dynamics 365 Supply Chain Management. And if you try to create this, you see that the dual write solution have to be installed first before you can you're able to use this template. So yeah, this is quite interesting. There's also a blog post written about this functionality. It's really interesting. Yeah, and then again, finance operation has been the integration has been, they've been building on integration for much longer time than, for instance, with Business Central. So you see that integration with the Dynamics 365 apps can be interesting. So I've here drawn a line. So the apps within the boundary of the line, except customer insight, they all are based on Dataverse. So you have the sales app, customer service app, customer voice app, customer insight uses Azure Data Lake. So that one should be included. But yeah, this can be interesting. Like for the instance, for the lead to cash process, you maybe want to use sales, but then also finance. Based on the dual write framework and virtual entities, you can build these integrations. So that's one of the conclusions that Microsoft Dataverse is at the center of an integrated Dynamics 365 business application platform. So looking back, 2017, rebranding to Dynamics 365, one family. Now, we're 4 years, 4 years later, finally, we're beginning to see that it's becoming more and better integrated. Yeah, and Microsoft has put Dataverse in the center of that. So, yeah, it's good to know that's there, and you can't ignore it. It's here to stay. So, looking to the future, how can I start? If you're interested to find out what can Dataverse mean for you. Something about licensing and what's next in relation to the release wave. Now you can start an 4-hour apps per user plan trial. You get a trial from 25 users for 30 days, and it gives you opportunity to create trial environments and build your own Dataverse apps and things like that in your integration. So that can be the first step to try out a proof of concept. And if you have a business case, if proof of concept is accepted, then you can convert the trial environments to production or sandbox environments once you purchase the appropriate licenses. Another one that's not a temporary trial, it's the community plan. It's a free development environment for individual use. So if you activate that for yourself, you're the only user, you can't share your apps, but you have the full functionality available and it's for always. So it's really a good start to go and enable this and start your adventure with Dataverse. Now, something about licensing. It's always fun to talk about licensing. So with licensing, it's all about capacity, so database capacity, storage capacity, and also licensing for users. So there are some Dataverse capabilities within Microsoft 365 licenses. But if you want to make it possible that users can create or use apps based on Power Apps, Canvas apps, or model-driven apps, you need the standalone Power Apps licensing. If you're using Dynamics, then Dataverse capabilities are included in the Dynamics licenses. But I'm here talking about the pure Power Platform licensing. So you can get a license for the Power Apps. With Power Automate licensing, you also get extra capacity. And there's also a default capacity per tenant that comes available once you purchase Power Apps per user plan. At least if you purchase one, then this will be unlocked. And you can you could purchase extra capacity add-ons per 1 gig. So there's limited Dataverse financially included in Microsoft 365 licenses. You will see if you have in the admin center, if you look at the licenses, you see that there's a part called Common Data Service. It's not yet renamed to Dataverse, but that means that you are entitled to use the Dataverse within the default environment. Because some apps like Microsoft Project, they make use of Dataverse, and this is in support of that. So within the Dataverse default environment, you're covered, but it's really limited. So if you're going to purchase standalone Power Apps licenses, you're able to run two apps for a per app plan, and these are the capacities you get per app plan license. So it's plus 50 MB for database, 400 MB for file, and so on. You see that the Dataverse capabilities within that part of the Office 365 of Microsoft 365 licenses, they don't add any capacity to the total. Looking at Power Automate per-user plan, you also see that you get additional capacity. Now, there's also default capacity per tenant, and if you buy at least one Power Apps per-user plan, that will be unlocked, so we will get 10 gigs database capacity. And you have to know that to create an environment, to be able to create an environment, you need at least 1 gigabit of free space. So this will give you enough to at least create one environment. So for instance, in the portal Power Apps portal scenario, you were able to create a production environment. You can create your portal, and then you can store your data. And this can be one Power Apps per user plan can be enough, depending on how much data you're going to store. But for such and to start with, it's a good start, good position. Now here are some list prices. So with an enterprise agreements or other kind of agreements, it's possible to get some discounts. There are some limited offers for per app plan and per user plan licenses. But these are the list prices. So it's like $10 per user per app per month for Power Apps plan. And per user plan is like $40 per user per month. You see that the additional database capacity is not cheap, but yeah, it's not just storage in like with SQL or in Azure. It's storage in a platform that offers so much more than only a database. It's good to know that if you have Dynamics 65 apps enabled in your Dataverse, and you have also Power Apps licensing, you're able to use those Dynamics 65 tables. There's only a small set of executive tables where you can't create or update or delete those rows in those tables, but it's only a small set. So for instance, for the lead table is free to use. So you can create your own Canvas app to create or model-driven app to create leads that are part of the sales app. And qualifying a lead, that kind of logic, functionality, that's restricted. So creating leads, okay, but take the next step and qualify it into an opportunity, that's restricted. Then you need Dynamics licensing. So what's next? What's in the release wave one plan for Dataverse and Business Central and Finance Operation? What's interesting and related to Dataverse? So there's a new export of data to Azure SQL database coming. So there is already a data export service, but this is a new feature that will be come available this year. Then I also mentioned before, trigger flows when a Microsoft Dataverse action is called. According to the information, it provides even better integration with finance and operations. So that can be interesting for some cases, maybe for the lead to cash process. Then, of course, virtual tables for Microsoft Dataverse in Business Central. Now, hopefully, they will have CRUD support and will be GA as soon as possible. So, we can build beautiful integrations between Dataverse and Business Central. And with for F&O, finance operations, there will be phase four for the dual write framework. So, last tip before I end, I mentioned also this in the session of André. There's a tool called CRM Toolbox. It can be really a big help in administering and configuring the Dataverse environments. So if you're interested, you can take a look what it has to offer once you're on your start with your adventure exploring Dataverse. So Luc, are there any questions?
I have two questions and there's none on the list. I think you did a very clear presentation and probably that showed also by the fact of that there are not that many questions, but maybe people start to feed them in. I have a practical question. You were referring to a GitHub repo where you could find examples, etc. Is it possible to share me the link so I will put it on the recording? So on the YouTube, I'll always put an index, etc. Then I can add a link to that repo. Yeah?
Yeah, so that's good. Yeah.
That's a very practical one. The last part of your slides where you talked about what's next, the future, was it wave one or wave two you were discussing? Because wave one has just been released.
It's wave one. Okay. It's wave one, but I can show you that. For instance, here it's the wave one and virtual tables for Microsoft Dataverse for Business Central.
Oh, so it should be there already.
It should be there, and that's something that also Andre Balodin also demonstrated that.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's still in preview, but on the Dataverse side, it's already GA with full CRUD support. So on the Dataverse side, they're ready, but on the business central side, not yet, I guess. Yeah. So once this will be general available, it will be very interesting.
Yeah, clear. There's one remark popping up here from Greg Enns. This was wonderful. Thank you for explaining this. This is the first time I felt like I clearly understood how CRM fits into Dataverse and how PC will fit into the picture. So thank you.
No, thank you very much. That sounds like a compliment.
it really is. It doesn't sound like it is. and like I said, it was very clear. I really like your way of presenting, I must say.
You're welcome.
My compliment too. We're nicely on time. I think if nobody has any question, wait a little bit. No, there's nothing popping in. We're going to close down. So let me take over to go to my last slide. This should be in view right now, I think. Yes. So, by the way, David Singleton is also typing in. Nice presentation. Thanks. Thank you, everybody, for being here. A special thanks to you, Stefan. Loud and clear, everything was.
You're welcome.
If you want to get in touch with us, whatever way you know, this email address, whatever, make use of it. So we're going to close down. Stefan, thank you very much. People are leaving already. So I'm going to stop the recording. Thanks, everybody, and have a nice evening, a good day, a good night.
Thank you.